In 1950, this is how much carbon dioxide every nation on Earth emitted. On this map, every yellow marker represents 10 million tons of carbon dioxide emitted yearly. We also mark nations between 1 and 10 million tons with a blue marker, and nations below 1 million tons with a silver marker. On this map, emissions are visualized according to current-day geographical borders and divisions. So the emissions of, for example, the Soviet Union are distributed to the individual, now sovereign, republics within it. Here we can see how emissions develop over time. Up until quite recently, the United States and Western Europe, alongside Russia and Japan, stood for the vast majority of the world's emissions. With economic development, other nations followed. But at this time, still the Western nations had extensive domestic raw materials extraction and heavy industry, and a small share of the emissions was the result of exported goods. By the 1960s and early 1970s, we can see the industries in China emerge, and the emissions from the world's most populous nation rises. In Europe, Germany dominates alongside Russia. By the 1980s, Russia is the clear number two, after the US, but ahead of fast-rising China. In the US and Western Europe, emissions are starting to slowly peak, when more production is moved overseas and global trade shoots through the roof. By the early 1990s, following the fall of the Soviet Union, the emissions of most former Soviet republics falls drastically. India is now growing fast, and emissions from other low and middle income nations like South Africa and Brazil are now notable. The emissions in the US has passed 5 billion tons annually, and will continue up to over 6 billion by the start of the 21st century. China stands at 3.5 billion tons by the turn of the millennium, but during the first decade of the 2000s, China's emissions close to threefold. In 2014, China is but an inch away from 10 billion tons of annual emissions of carbon dioxide. At the same time, India grows past Russia, and the US emissions slowly decreases to just over 5 billion tons. The numbers for 2020 are significantly lower than 2019 due to the halted trade and travel during the coronavirus pandemic for a clear majority of the nations. China is one of the few that saw emissions increase during 2020. Preliminary numbers for 2021 shows that the global decline was highly temporary, despite the pandemic still ongoing. If we focus on specific regions, we can see that the emissions in Europe has first increased, stagnated, and then slowly fallen over the course of these 70 years. The United States follow a similar pattern, even though the peak came later. The emissions from oil-rich Middle Eastern nations start to increase in the 70s and 80s. Most well-populated Asian nations increase its emissions in the 90s and the 2000s, and the trend is similar for South America. In Africa, with the exception of South Africa, the numbers are still very low by comparison, but the numbers are rising with development.
We will now shift focus and look at emissions per capita.
So here, markers indicate 1 ton of emitted carbon dioxide per inhabitant and year. Now, the map looks very different. Here, countries in blue have emissions above 20 tons per capita. Countries in purple have emissions between 15 and 20 tons, in pink, between 10 and 15, in red between 5 and 10, in orange between 1 and 5, and in yellow below 1 ton per person and year. In the top bracket, we find a bunch of relatively sparsely populated nations, geographically small but economically vibrant countries and small island nations. Oil-rich Qatar tops ahead of Mongolia, Trinidad and Tobago, Brunei, Kuwait and Bahrain. Of the large emitters, the US is at place 11, with over 14 tons per person and year, while Russia is at place 19. Germany is number 29, and the UK at number 58. China used to be much lower on this list, but now it sits at place 32, with over 7 tons per person and year. India is down at place 111, with 1.7 tons. And towards the bottom of the list, we find most of the poorest nations in the world, with populous Democratic Republic of the Congo at the absolute bottom, with less than 0.03 tons per person and year.
Like we saw in the beginning, Western states have been responsible for the majority of the emissions historically, with middle and low-income nations catching up more recently. So what region or nation has emitted the most throughout history?
This is how the emissions up until 1950 was distributed. One marker here represents 1 billion tons of carbon dioxide emitted accumulatively. So every marker here is the equivalent of 100 markers in our first visualization. We divide the world into 11 regions, the United States in a darker blue, and the rest of North America in a lighter blue, South America in green, Africa in yellow, the current nations in the European Union plus the UK in pink, the rest of Europe including Russia in purple, China in red, India in gold, the rest of Asia in orange, Oceania in brown, and finally international transportation in silver. The last category had by 1950 not yet reached 1 billion tons emitted. With time, we can see how the emissions build up. Today, 1.7 trillion tons of carbon dioxide has been released into the atmosphere as a result of human action. The United States stands at a quarter of that, despite only accounting for 4% of the world's population as of right now. The EU plus the UK has emitted 22% of the emissions, with only 6.5% of the world's population. China has emitted 14% of the total and has 18% of the world's population. Africa has a similar population as China, 17.5% of the world, but has emitted only 2.8% of the total carbon dioxide.
But there is one more factor we need to weigh in to these numbers we saw earlier for 2020.
We can see the trend in most of Europe and the US is negative, that the emissions are slowly coming down, which is, of course, a good development overall. But how much of this development is a result of extraction and production moving overseas? In a globalized world, with a lower cost of production in, for example, Bangladesh rather than France, it is often cheaper to produce thousands of miles away from the final consumer and ship it across the world's oceans or airspace. An abundance of low-skilled workers demanding low wages, lesser environmental protection and regulation, and advantages of scale in production means that global trade has increased drastically in the last few decades. On this map, we can see how much emissions are embedded in global trade. Nations with a positive number, hence countries that import goods and services, where emissions are, in the numbers we have looked at so far, counted somewhere else, are marked in red. One marker indicates 10 million tons of CO2 emissions. Nations who produce and export, who account for emissions in their numbers that are consumed outside its borders, are marked in green. One marker indicates 10 million tons of CO2. And this is per capita, the emissions, if we adjust for emissions embedded in trade. The numbers are similar than before, but accentuated. The emissions in, for example, France increase from 4 to 6 tons per person a year. In the UK, from 4 to 7. In the US, from 14 to 17. South Africa is now lowered from 7 to 5, and the numbers are also lowered in some Asian nations, but not by as much as it used to be. Today, China's number, for example, stay close to the same, even if we account for trade. This shows that there is definitely truth to the claim that so-called offshoring of emissions are happening. But it does not explain the entire drop in emissions in the EU and the US. These nations have also made changes within their own borders. While they all still have much higher emissions than would be necessary for reaching any global temperature increase targets, real change has happened, and for the most part at the same time as the economies of these nations in total and per capita has increased.
We will in part 2 of this video come back to the sources of emissions and look at how these changes might have taken place. But for now, we will go back to our first map of carbon dioxide emissions for 2020.
This map does not paint the whole picture when it comes to human impact on the climate of our planet. Carbon dioxide is the main greenhouse gas from human activity, but not the only one. CO2 accounts for somewhere between 70 and 80% of human-induced climate change. Three other types of emissions are important to look at. First, we will remove the smaller nations from this map and go back to 2018, when we can compare CO2 emissions with other gases. In orange, we will add methane emissions. Methane does not have the same effect per ton released, and different gases stay in the atmosphere for different amounts of time. But here, these numbers are shown in carbon dioxide equivalents. So one orange block of methane affects global warming just as much as one yellow block of carbon dioxide. This makes comparisons easier. As we can see, these emissions are distributed differently across the globe. In purple, we add emissions of nitrous oxide. And in black, the fourth and final of the main greenhouse gases, fluorinated gases.
In part two of this video, we will look more closely at the sources of emissions and why levels of different greenhouse gases can vary between nations, and take a look at the consequences of climate change. Thank you so much for watching this short introduction into global emissions. One of the main sources of greenhouse gases is our food production. I have a couple of videos on that topic featured towards the end of the video.